Proceed to the next talk. Switch to a completely different subject here. All right. Right, so the next talk is about a cryptographic reverse firewall via malleable smooth projecting hash functions. All right, by Rong Mao Cheng, Ying Mu, Yu Ming Yang, Willis Susilo, Fun Chung Gyu, and Mingwu Zhang. So they're from the University of Wollongong, Australia. And I guess Mingwu Zhang is from Hubei University of Technology, China. And the work will be presented by Gyu Ming.
Thank you for the introduction. So I'm coming from University of Wollongong. So today I will present our work on crypto reverse firewall from malleable smooth projective hash functions. Okay, so first I will give an introduction for the background, and then I will briefly introduce what is a crypto reverse firewall. And then I will introduce our new notion called malleable smooth projective hash. So, and then we show how to use this new primitive to construct CRF for different functionalities, including message transmission, obvious signature-based envelope protocol, and also the obvious transfer protocol. All right, so the background, I think we have heard a lot about Edward Snowden and then the mass surveillance and the backdoor. So basically, all these shows that basically some powerful actors, such as intelligence agencies, they can subvert the implementation of crypto algorithms or protocols, and then by using the subverted mechanism, so they can bypass the security protection, even if we use a standardized encryption scheme, for example. So the good news is now we are all aware of this incidents. Now, basically, we have the so-called post-Snowden cryptography. So basically, we want to achieve meaningful security. So even when the implementation of the of those mechanisms have been tampered with by some, for example, powerful actors like intelligence agencies or some major IT companies. All right, so this is also an announcement and a statement published by ICR in Eurocrypt 2014. So basically, this statement is calling for research and development of efficient techniques for protecting the leakage of private information through the subverted crypto implementations. All right, so so we have heard about some techniques, for example, the cryptography and all the deterministic mechanism to prevent the leakage of the secret information. So there is another useful tool called crypto reverse firewall. So this was introduced in Eurocrypt 2015. So what is a crypto reverse firewall? So it's just like a normal firewall. So for the normal firewall, basically the basic functionality is to do filtering, right? So we just filter the message, mainly the incoming message, the inbound message. However, for crypto reverse firewall, basically This is to protect the leakage from a crypto algorithm. And we call it reverse firewall because basically we want to prevent the leakage from the inside. So because if we have some like a subverted algorithm here, then this algorithm may leak information through some subliminal channel. All right, so basically if we have some protocol here, like for example, you can have a key exchange protocol, you can have a message transmission protocol, then we build a shield outside. So this is like a shield outside the machine. Then all the message will be basically processed by this firewall in order to prevent the leakage. All right, so this approach is quite different from other approach. For example, some other approach like using deterministic scheme or using the so-called cryptography. So they need to maybe modify the implementation. But here we don't need to do any modification on the underlying system. So basically we just add a shield outside this system. All right, so this is the basic definition. And the nice feature of, besides the transparency, basically we don't need to touch this part, the original system, and we can also stack the firewall. So basically we can build different layers. So all these layers can work smoothly. That means, so if you want the firewall to be robust, you may put several different firewalls, and just like in the mixnet, if you have one of them working, then your system will be secure. So this is a good feature of a crypto firewall. So there are some properties we should satisfy. The first property is obvious. We should maintain the functionality of the underlying scheme. So that means the firewall, this crypto firewall, should be transparent to the end users. So basically, from end user's viewpoint, so this firewall should be transparent. And then the second property is security preserving. So the firewall should not introduce any security problem for the underlying protocol. That means if the protocol is secure, then this firewall should not destroy the security of the underlying protocol. The third property is obvious. We want to prevent any leakage from the subverted algorithm. All right, so I will describe a little bit more about these three properties. So first is quite straightforward. So basically the firewall, if we have a firewall here, it should just, so the protocol should just work smoothly as without a firewall. All right, so this is quite straightforward. For the security preserving, so if we have an honest implementation of the algorithm, security algorithm, so the firewall should not affect security. So this is, again, quite straightforward. However, so we also consider some like a stronger notion of security preserving. So here we consider that this is a algorithm that has been tampered with, and we want to still maintain security even we have some subverted algorithm here, right? So here we have two notions. One is called a strong security preserving. That means we want to preserve the security of a protocol even if the protocol has been arbitrarily tampered with. And then we have the weak security preserving. That means so the protocol may be tampered with, but it will maintain the functionality of the original protocol. So to give an example of this weak security preserving, for example, so we want to encrypt a message, right? So now, but I want to maybe leak one bit of the message being encrypted. So how to leak it? So basically you can just maybe choose a position, one position. So this position is known by the adversary when the adversary plants the backdoor inside the system. So for example, the ice position is the bit of the message this algorithm want to leak. Then the algorithm can simply, if it's a randomized algorithm, it can simply run the algorithm repeatedly using different randomness until the ice bit becomes a bit it wants to leak. Then in this case, it still preserves the functionality. But however, the outsider can, from output, for example, ice bit of ciphertext, we can learn, okay, the ice bit of the encrypted message is 0 or 1. So this is one example of a weak security preserving. So strong security preserving means, so no matter, we don't care about whether the subverted algorithm maintains functionality or not. All right, so this is about the security, and then we also need to consider the adversaries. So we can consider eavesdropper as one type of adversary, and also we can consider the peer party as another potential adversary, because the peer party may want to learn some secret from the other side, so which it should not learn. according to original protocol. So this is a security preserving. And then another notion, the third notion is this exfiltration or leakage resilient. So basically, the idea is that so we should not allow any secret information to be leaked. So it's defined using this game. So basically, we let adversary choose, for example, a subverted version of the algorithm, and then we run. So we have two words. In this word, we run this subverted algorithm, and in the other word, we run the honest algorithm. So then the output will be processed by a firewall, and then the adversary need to distinguish whether it's in this subverted word or the honest word. So basically, if we have this exfiltration resistance, that means adversary cannot distinguish which word it is. So basically, the requirement here is the adversary should not be able to tell whether the algorithm behind the firewall is an honest algorithm or a modified algorithm. All right, so this is a so-called exfiltration resistance. So again, we can define strong and weak exfiltration resistance. And we can also look at the adversary at different levels. So eavesdropper is a weak level, and then the peer party can be a stronger adversary. All right, so there is also some relationship between this notion and the previous one, the security preserving notion, because we can easily see that, okay, if the protocol is secure, and if we have exfiltration resistance, then it will be security preserving, especially for privacy or confidentiality related security notions. So the reason is that, so if this is an honest implementation, that means it has some security, it preserves some security. And basically the firewall here, so I need to mention here, the firewall will not share any secret with this protocol. So firewall, what the firewall needs is just some fresh random coin. So basically, if this is honest implementation and it has some security, then this firewall will not violate the security for sure, because this is just a public function using some random coin. So it will not violate, for example, the confidentiality. Now, so if we have a subverted algorithm, so if from this subverted algorithm, if we can leak information here, then basically we can distinguish these two words for sure. So once we have this exfiltration resistance, that means adversary cannot distinguish these two words. And if the underlying protocol is secure, then we can make sure, even if this is a subverted algorithm, then it will, after the message going through the firewall, it will still preserve the security. So this is the relationship between this exfiltration resistance and the security preserving. So basically, this also tells us, so when we analyze security, if we can have the exfiltration resistance, then it implies the security preserving. All right, so that's the background about the crypto reverse firewall. And then in Eurocrypt 2015, where the notion was proposed, so there is a question. So we want to find a full categorization of functionalities and the security properties for which crypto reverse firewall exists. And this work, we try to partially answer this question. So basically, we build a generic approach for designing crypto reverse firewalls for functionalities that are realizable by the smooth projective hash functions. So actually, this is very useful primitive for like a security, privacy or confidentiality related functionalities. So later we will see the applications that can be realized by smooth projective hash. Okay, so the second part, so this is one of the major contributions of this work. So we introduce a new notion called malleable smooth projective hash. So first I will briefly introduce what is a smooth projective hash. So basically the notion was proposed by Kramer Shoup in 2002. So for a smooth project hash, so we have a domain X and a range Y. So it actually it's a family of functions. So if we can define a family of functions which will map elements from domain X to the range Y. So the domain X can be separated, actually be separated into two sets. One is we call it language L. One is elements not in the language L. So we have several functions. So first is a hash function, and then the projection hash function. So hash function will take a secret hash key. So for the project hash, we have a secret key, which is a hash key, and a projection key, which can be derived from the secret key. You can treat this as a like a private key, this as a public key. So to compute the hash, if the element is in language L, that means there is a witness which can prove this element is in language L, then we can calculate the hash in two ways, either using the secret key or the projection key. So if we use public key, we need to use a witness. So basically, if you look at the encryption, so this is a decryption key, and this is like the randomness. Witness is just a randomness. So we can produce a hash either using the witness or the secret hash key. However, for the elements that are not in the language L, so that means we don't have any witness, obviously we cannot use this method because there is no witness at all. So we can only use the secret hash key. All right, so there are several properties. First is correctness. So if the element is in L, then the two hashes should be the same. And the second property is the smoothness. So if the element is not in L, then this hash value is basically unrelated to the projection key. So from the projection key, you cannot learn any information about this hash value, right? So this is basically this hash value will be statistically indistinguishable from the uniform distribution in this range one. All right, so we also require the membership problem, subset membership problem, to be difficult. That means no polynomial time algorithm can distinguish element from L and outside L. So we also require this to be true even if the adversary knows the secret hash key. Even the adversary knows the secret hash key, so these problems should still be difficult. Right, so that's the smooth projective hash. So in our work, we extend this notion to build the so-called malleable smooth projective hash. So we introduce a few functions. So these are just some quite straightforward functions. So it allows us to sample some randomness used to generate the hash key and the witness. And these four functions are the major functions we will require. So first we have a so-called malleable key function. So it takes some randomness generated by the first sampling algorithm, and then it will just randomize the hash key, or the projection key. So it will produce a new projection key. And then for responding to this malleable key function, there is a malleable hash function. So basically we can use this same randomness and a word to calculate this killed hash value. So this is basically the difference between the original hash value for the C and the new hash value using this randomized hash key, projection key, sorry. And then similarly, this is for the hash key and the projection key. And here we have another two algorithms for the element re-randomization. So we can re-randomize an element using some randomness sampled from the second sampling algorithm. And then we can also similarly calculate this hash value, which is the difference between the original hash value and the new hash value for this new word. So below I will show some pictures to demonstrate these functions. So this is basically the original smooth projective hash. So basically we can calculate the hash in two ways. If the C is in the language, so that means if there exists a witness. So we can use a projection hash, or we can use a secret hash key to calculate the hash value. And these two values must be the same. Now we introduce this malleable key function. That means even a projection key and some randomness we sample from this algorithm, then we can modify this projection key to a new projection key. And we require that, so this projection key should be independent from the original projection key. That means, so in the paper we define security game, adversary will provide two projection key, HP0 and HP1, and then we use this function to randomize one of them, and we require that the adversary cannot distinguish which from the output, which one is the original projection key chosen by the simulator. So this is make sure this randomized key is unrelated to the original projection key. And then, of course, we should be able to calculate a new hash value from this. If this is element C is in the language L, so we can use a new hash key to calculate the hash value. So, however, we need to have some relationship between these two hash values. So basically, we require that we can use this malleable hash function to calculate the difference. So if we combine this difference with the original hash value, we can get a new hash value, and these two values must be the same. So this is for the projection key malleability. All right. Similarly, we have the element re-randomizability. So given an element, so we can re-randomize it using this re-randomizing element algorithm. Similarly, we require that. So for any C, so the element C can be in the language or with outside the language. So C can be element in the domain X. So after we do the re-randomization, basically this new re-randomized element should be somehow independent from the original element. So we can also define similar game. So adversary can choose two C0 and C1. So we don't require C0s or C1 to be in language. So they can be any element in the domain X. Then we do this re-randomization, and then we require that the output, from the output adversary cannot tell which element was chosen for the re-randomization process. So similarly, if we have this modified or re-randomized element, so we can calculate the hash value similar to the previous property for the projection key. So we require that there exists another algorithm that can calculate the difference between the two hash values. So if we combine this difference with the original one, we can calculate the new hash value. All right. So the third requirement is that this process should not change the membership of the underlying element. So basically, we show that if we look at this smooth project hash defined using the graded ring. So this was proposed by BCC in crypto 2013. So we can actually construct a malleable smooth project hash from this smooth project from the graded ring. So here actually we simplify this construction. So besides, we prove in our paper that if this theta is a identity function, and then this gamma is a constant function, then this smooth project from the graded ring is actually a malleable smooth project hash. And we show a concrete example from the k-linear assumption to make sure to show that this malleable smooth project is actually feasible. And later, actually, we will see another example which does not require these conditions. So we will see another example. So here we can see quite easily. So for example, the element re-randomizability can be achieved by this hard subset membership problem. Because here, we just if this gamma is a constant function, that means this will generate a word. However, according to the hard subset membership problem, so this word is indistinguishable from an element from the whole domain X. That means we can use this simply use a hybrid argument to replace this with a random element from the domain X, then this will hide the original word, no matter this C is within language L or not. So this is a intuition how to prove it. So the second part of our contribution is we show how to use this malleable smooth project hash to construct crypto reverse firewalls for different applications. So first is a message transmission protocol. So basically, we can build a secure message transmission protocol using the smooth projective hash. So the basically receiver can generate a key pair and then send the projection key to the sender. Sender can simply use a witness, sample a word and witness, and then calculate the hash value and then use the hash value to hide the message. And the receiver can recover the message using the secret hash key. All right. So now how to build the firewall. So basically, we try to re-randomize this projection key. So we can simply use the two algorithms. So first, we sample some randomness, and then we use this malleable key function to re-randomize this projection key. However, so if we do this, basically, the original receiver cannot recover the message because now the projection key has been changed. So that's why we need to apply the malleable hash function to basically removes some this delta V, which is introduced when we update this projection key. So once we remove this part, then the original receiver can just recover the original message. So it can be shown easily that this will preserve the functionality. And then it will provide strong exfiltration resistance because we have the so-called projection key indistinguishability, because this randomized projection key will not leak any information. So through this randomization process, basically, this key will be independent from the original projection key. So there is no information leakage from the from this output after going through the firewall. And then for the Alice, we can similarly do the re-randomization using these two algorithms. So we randomize the element, and then we use this re-randomizing hash function to calculate the difference. To calculate a delta V here, we can use this delta VD to hide, to re-randomize original ciphertext. However, here, we different from the previous one here, we don't need to actually do any other process, because once you use hash key on the updated element, it will automatically calculate the hash value, which is a combination of the original hash value V here and the delta V here. So we don't need to do a second process to remove this delta V. So this is the difference. And however, here we can only provide the weak exfiltration resistance. So the reason is that, so if we consider strong exfiltration resistance, then adversary can arbitrarily modify the protocol. So adversary can actually leak information from this message M. So there is no way to prevent such kind of leakage. Because if an arbitrarily modified algorithm just leaked information from this M, so replace M with something else, then the receiver can definitely recover the leaked information. So there is no security against such kind of leakage. So however, for if this part maintains functionality, that means it can deliver the original message, then we can prove that this can maintain the exfiltration resistance. So this is the definition of weak exfiltration resistance. However, for the eavesdropper, so we can prove that actually this firewall can achieve the strong exfiltration resistance. And then the second protocol is similar, so we consider the obvious signature-based envelope. So it's similar to the message transmission, however. So here the language is more complicated. So we require the receiver to have some sort of credential. Only the valid receiver having some credential can recover the original message. All right, so I will just go through the slide quickly. So these are the steps are similar. So we just re-randomize the word or the for this receiver, and then we re-randomize the hash key for the sender. So in this case, and we can have some similar results, similar to the secure message transmission. And here I just want to show that actually here the language is more complicated. So you can see here the language is any word that is a linear encryption of the water signature. So in particular, in this for such kind of language, so this theta is no longer an identity function. So that means we can build malleable smooth project hash from different structures, mathematical structures. All right, so the last part is obvious transfer. So here the obvious transfer, so the only difference between from the obvious transfer and the first two protocols is that here we need to achieve the so-called verifiable smoothness, because we need to make sure so that the receiver can only receive one of the messages. So in order to do so, we need to make sure the two words, basically we use two words to do the encryption. The two words, only one of them can be in the language. So how to do it? So we use the so-called these two algorithms. One is the sample algorithm, one is the pair algorithm. So we make sure that the receiver can generate one word. If this is C, B is in the language, then the sender can generate another word which is outside the language. However, if the CB is outside language, then the C1 minus B will be inside language. So in this way, we can make sure so that the sender can make sure that one of the these two words will be outside the language, so that the receiver cannot recover both messages. So that's the first modification. And the second modification, basically here we try to use an untrusted setup. That means we ask the receiver to generate the generators or the bases. So that's the second difference. And so in order to address this difference. So basically, we introduce another algorithm that will re-randomize the element basis. That means even if we have an untrusted setup, we can re-randomize the element basis. And then the other part is similar to the previous protocols. All right, so this is basically the instantiation of the OT protocol. So we can capture the original OTCIF construction in the Eurocrypt paper, and actually we can build a more efficient variant of this protocol. All right, so that's the major part. And finally, to conclude, so basically we show how to build this new notion called the malleable smooth project hash from the gridded ring and from the smooth project hash. And then we ask whether there is other way to construct it. So one difficulty is, for example, for ISA or Q, ECR or QR based structure. So basically, we cannot easily re-randomize the modulus. So that's the difficult part for those kind of structures. And then we also ask whether we can build other applications and the corresponding CIFs from this new notion. So that's all for my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, we have almost no time for questions. Just a short question, perhaps, otherwise, while you're preparing. Yeah. All right, let's thank the speaker again.